Ja, herzlich willkommen zurück auf dem Fem-Channel. Gleich lässt die Fem ein wenig die Hosen runter, denn
Welcome to the talk.
Jenny,
das ist doch hart.
Wird gleich eine That
is, but it is high availability by Jenny.
Systeme, von denen wir
This talk is being translated into English for you by Jörn and Attila E.
Doch nicht
Any feedback
so
is appreciated. Please use the hashtag C3Lingo on Twitter or Mastodon. We hope you enjoy the talk. For this talk, there will unfortunately be no Q&A and no breakout sessions. Because Jenny doesn't have that much time right now, unfortunately.
If you want to hear the English translation,
this talk will also be translated into English, as you hear right now. And you are already in the English translation. Now, please enjoy. This is high availability.
Hello, I'm Jenny. I'm going to talk about high availability constructs.
Erstmal ganz kurz.
Out of funny reasons, they might not be as high availability as thought.
Und ebenfalls
so, shortly, who am I? I'm a computer science student since 2017 and also in the resort technology of the FEM. I also am responsible for software constructs in the internet.
Da könnte man jetzt
Hier ist mein E-Mail, mein Mastodon, mein Twitter, mein GitHub.
Ein kurzer Ausblick, das eben war die
Einführung. But if you know, want to know what I do, just a quick overview. This is the introduction. I'll talk about my motivation and also the reasons why high availability constructs are falling apart. Why are we doing this? The FEM. At the FEM, we have large software constructs, self-made constructs, and they are far more complicated.
Und heute wollen wir uns die Gründe für diese lustigen
And that's why they fall apart out of funny or actually sad reasons. And now we'll talk about the reasons and we'll take a look at it. Let's start with something which I don't have as much exposure to, with the Jitsi. The FEM operates a Jitsi instance. In the past, this only has been one VM, but since Corona started and everything went online, the demand was to have a Jitsi. It had to be expanded. And that's what happened. There has been a master VM, which has been globally reachable, and several video bridges, and that were controlled by the master. And the master VM has public IPs, IPv4, IPv6 from the standalone VM, and that has been turned off, the standalone VM. There has been a problem. If you look at the Proxmox configuration, here we can see that Start and at boot has been forgotten to turn off. And that at the Proxmox update, it led to problems. Namely, that if we rebooted the node, the VM also was on afterwards. And it also took its statically configured IP. And this also has been assigned to the master. This also led to it being broken, half broken, because we have two masters. Because according to the old standalone VM was not so-and-so. And what's interesting, the Jitsi was still largely usable.
Whatever, and
so you could do conferences, people didn't hear each other, sometimes people couldn't connect, and we asked ourselves, why is that? According to our GC admin, you could use SSH to connect, but it still worked. The old master VM was turned off, everything has worked since then afterwards. Now about something that I have even a little more exposure to, Web1. What is Web1? The Web1 is a web cluster of the FEM. I was managing it. It's largely been used for web hosting for us, for the FEM, but also for other clubs and other at the uni. Lots of institutions have relied, and also us, have relied on the web cluster, and we have put a special eye onto high availability of this web cluster. I've made an overview of this web one for LaTeX. Ich get drawn, thank you to Next. I'll show you how this construct is put up, composed. We have two load balancers, one node number two, port 22 is also at web one, so that people can also log in through SFTP. And active node load balancer is forwarding the requests to the web nodes, two PHP nodes. Currently, there are two for PHP 7.1, two for 7.0 and 6.4. This is not state of the art, but I'm actually just managing it. I didn't set this up. Additionally, PHP applications can also use MySQL on the web nodes or Postgres, depending on what they need. This is our MySQL cluster. It consists of MariaDB with a master web application. It consists of two nodes, PS2, I built it myself. This is the only component I built myself. We have three nodes that are in hotstat by Postgres 13. We also have high availability here. All of those web nodes use an FS to access data on the high availability storage, depending on what the web page needs.
Damit sich
these files that are there,
eingeloggt haben,
it's also available on Web1 Manage through NSF. For those people who log in through SFTP, so that they can access their data. The authentication is happening against MySQL 2 through the
so viele Logins pflegen müssen.
People attached logins simply because we don't have as many logins. So we made it simplified there. Here, the HA Storage 1 is alone, standing alone. Is there a reason why it doesn't have a HA?
It was originally planned as high availability storage, and we wanted to realize this with a cluster FS, but then we realized it's actually not a good idea because it's slow, and that's why we rejected that idea. So now we only have one node which offers a network file system share. And when this node is down, then all PHP scripts are not available and all websites are down. And basically this is a single point of failure.
Was denn DRBD genau ist, da kommen wir gleich zu, bei dem Softwareklumpen, den wir uns mal anschauen werden.
We have,
und zwar ist unserer allseits geliebten
Admin-DB. We're going to talk about the next failure now, which is,
was ist denn eine Admin-DB?
The Admin-DB.
Ja, also grob gesagt ist die Admin-DB.
And some will wonder, what is the Admin-DB? The MNDB is the member database at FEM, and it is maintained by me and others, but I didn't build this, I'm just maintaining it, and it manages all devices in the FEMnet and configures switches. And if people join us, then with their devices, they have to register the devices. And then we keep track of what kind of devices are in our network, and they have to be university members or
public IPs, damit
and
man den weiß, wer, wann, was
the devices of the members get a static IP so that we know who did what and when.
DNS-Records
and
the IPs,
the That's why the AdminDB is also configuring the DHCP and DNS server.
Dann hier einmal eine sehr stark vereinfachte Struktur der AdminDB. Ich habe ein paar Notizen gemacht, wie ich das hier.
This is a very simplified structure of the AdminDB.
Ist das hier der AdminDB 2.
And I hope.
Die zentrale
Post- so I'm trying to explain this to you.
Und
this is the AdminDB2 DB. This is the central Postgres database. And it has a hot standby construct consisting of two masters and two slaves.
Die an dem aktiven Master anliegt. Und ja, das ist dann so realisiert, dass das DABD, also dass die Postgres-Daten
im DABD
liegen. DABD ist praktisch ein Web 1.
It works as follows.
Wait 1 übers Netzwerk.
So the data halt lies on a DABD.
Und ja, das
and
ist tatsächlich eine von Postgres.
Only one of the two nodes can be active at the same time.
Das Verzeichnis für alle Postgres liegt auf einem solchen DABD.
And this is actually a recommended way
und auf dem, der halt
by Postgres to realize this.
Device auf Primary gesetzt.
And this is how we do replication.
Und ja, dann ist der Primary. Genau.
And we have then, we have one block device and this block device is being mounted and this is how we have access to the data.
Genau, dann einmal ganz kurz der AdminDB 2 Web. Das ist
this didn't work as intended and we will come back to that again. We also have the Web Frontend here consisting of two nodes.
Was heißt dort Standby? Die sind beide immer aktiv, aber einer hat halt hier HAIP.
So one is Standby.
Web Frontend und um die AdminDB zu verwalten.
But only one of them has the high availability IP.
Immer aktive Free Radio Server gegen welche.
And we have AdminDB2 Radios. So these are two active Radio Servers. Die
Authentifizierung wird dann halt weitergegeben ans SQL, also der
which get contacted by the switches and who authenticate the switches. And the Radio Server checks for the MAC addresses and
dann sieht man hier auch, die Switche werden konfiguriert
and von determines which device gets access to which VLAN.
Ja, ich weiß
we
es
also have the AdminDB ext. So what is ext?
Also denke ich mal, es wird
and actually, I'm not quite sure what ext means in this context.
Da halt solche Dinge wie so DB2-Switch
based on the based on our wiki, this is extra services. Extra services
eingerichtet werden können. Sind zum Beispiel TACTV, das
and the switches are being configured automatically via SSH.
Switchboards, die werden halt darüber dann automatisch verwaltet, genau.
And
zusätzlich ist das Ding auch noch der primäre DNS-Server für alle unsere internen Zonen, die wir bei uns im Netz haben.
And we have, und, this is the primary DNS-Servers for our internal routing.
Postgres, weil PowerDNS kann sich aus
SQL. This is a PowerDNS Server.
Halt aus unserer Postgres-Datenbank und ja. Hier haben wir einfach wieder zwei Nodes, auch mit einem Arbiter-Node, die sich.
It takes it from the Postgres database and we also have two nodes, also with an Arbiter-Node, that share the services. Some, for example, on one, one things, some things run on one of them, and the other, the power DNS, whatever. Also, we have the AdminDB2 DNS. Those are the secondary DNS servers for internal zones. And also the DNS resolver, our clients receive through the DHCP these DNS servers. There are two.
Damit beide DNS IP
the high availability is for the IP to send the IP from the one to the other. So if one is not available,
clients
and
DHCP.
We also have an arbiter here, and the clients receive the IP addresses from the DHCP.
Zwei load-balancende DHCP Server, die halt in unterschiedlichen
VLAN. This is also fully high availability. Those are two load balancing DHCP servers.
4 bis 6 und da spielt
the node 1 is also in the VLAN 1 to 3, the second is VLAN 2 4 to 6. They also receive the configuration from the admin DB. There's also scripts. Additionally, you can see on this arrow the ArcWatch and what that is. We'll talk about this later. I just wanted to mention it here. All right, and now we'll talk about a few problems that might arise through this over-engineered design. Now let's talk about AdminDB2DB. This is a centralized Postgres database, and through that, the centerpiece of this AdminDB. High availability. As already mentioned, only the current primary node has the Postgres data mounted. The problem is, at stopping Postgres really wants to write to the disk that it's really stopped and that it's really shut down. But the problem is, before that happens, the DABD in a lot of cases has the failover made to a different node and doesn't have the data system and couldn't write that it has done a proper shutdown. The old node couldn't write that it's stopped. The new node couldn't start because Postgres seemingly hasn't been stopped properly. And then the AdminDB was broken and the FEMNET was broken completely. The radio servers, the DHCP server doesn't regenerate its config. You can't sign into the Wi-Fi. It's really difficult, and by and large, one by one, the network is broken if we do these type of things. Now, one last thing with the database. There's a specialty with us. You don't read talk directly to SQL tables, but to the with functions. This has the reason why, because writes are being checked. We have a simple tree design for writes, and you simply sign in with your Postgres credentials, and then you do the functions through your that. But functions can also have access to very sensitive data, so the intention is correct. But we want to log within transactions, but they shouldn't disappear at a broken or like a canceled transaction. But because you could say, I do very illegal things, I look at things that I'm not allowed to look at, and then I cancel the transaction. And that's why you could think what's your opinion. But we're putting this into practice through a Postgres function in Python. Yeah. And also logs into MongoDB. And now you can think about how intuitive you think this is or not. That's why on the DB monsters we have a replicated MongoDB, and then the logs are being written in there. Now I have a code snippet from the AdminDB log. I have a bit of a modified for this, but actually only this part is important.
Jedenfalls, was man hier
I hope you can see that. Normally this would have been a line all the way to here, but what you can see here for logging, it connects to the MongoDB on AdminDB Master
1.
This has the great effect that once we had the host off, which is the Master 1 redone, if Master 1 was off, Master 2 has the Postgres database in the primary, everything worked, it took its IP, you can't run any functions. I've looked it up, and that's pretty bad. Either you log on one node or on the same one right below. This little mistake could easily be resolved by changing the one to a two. If nothing is locked, even the DHCP config is being locked. That might also break the entire FEM network. So the old concept still works, but the DHCP updates can't be run. This breaks the FEM network.
Genau, dann
ist once again
die nächste Komponente, die ab und zu mal kaputt
breaks the high availability.
Und
now one more component that breaks sometimes is our DHCP server. The wired device in the FEM network gets a public IP address, because if you connect through wire, you get at least a gigabit connection, and nutting a gigabit to several people might not be a good idea for many. So that's why we do public IP for addresses. But we don't have actually a lot of those. And additionally, the IPs are statically assigned according to the MAC address. This is the reason that we know in abuse cases which device has which address. But if an IP address is freed, then that can also be really reassigned really quickly. That's why we have a lease lifetime of 5 minutes. But we also have 5,000 devices in the FEMnet, but this means every of those 5,000 devices, let's assume if they are active at the same time, they get to the DHCP server, and every 5 minutes they request whether their IP is still valid. That's why the DHCP server has a lot of fun, a lot of work to do. Additionally to the normal DHCP server, we also have the task, what I've already mentioned, the OpWatch on admindb2ext. So what is OpWatch? It looks for at the VLAN, in the VLAN for ARP, and looks whether the IP is connected to the right MAC address. And it says which IP address is assigned to which MAC address. And if the DHCP is completely through, a postscript is called, which on a Redis writes on admindb that this MAC has this IP address at a certain time. We can talk whether this is the right solution or not, but at least this OpWatch script writes an email if there's an IP address that is assigned to a MAC address that it doesn't know. So there are a lot of these, just to say that. But that leads to the DHCP server after 5 minutes, it has to assign a new lease to all devices and call OpWatch. And in the past, it's been a way, that's why I'm talking about this now in our construct, a single DHCP server, one process was responsible for all VLANs. The DHCP construct was on two nodes, but it was as a hot node. Just one was active, and one process was responsible for our VLANs. And at peak times, the DHCP didn't have any fun. It just simply broke because of the high demand. The DHCP was broken, and restart didn't help. The DHCP requests still came through, and then the legacy internet IP was broken. And you can see all the emails, because people mentioned that only Google is possible and nothing else works. Yeah,
that was a small insight into our infrastructure, and there are more things that actually failed, but these were the highlights that I also had to work with, and I very much thank you for your attention, and goodbye.
Yeah, next.
Thanks for this really nice and interesting talk.
Und 20:15
and also thank you for your attention from the translation booth. You just heard the talk, Das ist doch HA, that is, but it is High Availability by Jenny. It was translated by Jörn and Attila E. If you have feedback for us, please use the hashtag C3Lingo. Goodbye.